I couldn't figure that out. And someone said, well, air is some of your best.
Open her sign.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone.
No energy.
We're here. We made it.
It's not the same without you.
We're so glad you could join us today. Feel free to stand and worship with us today. We're going to start with some praise and worship. Get moving. Maybe get warmer. Our first song is Forever. Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, His love endures forever. You know who you are.
Thank you.
salvation, O Lord of my
then through the darkness. Well, I surprised Ruth by getting in old camp meeting mode where you break out and you shake hands and sing this little item. I haven't sang that song in years, but that's an oldie and a goodie. How are we all doing this morning? Good to see you. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Can I get on the mic or is this all right?
You're doing good.
I'll get a little closer. Is this camera going to be okay if I move up a little closer?
Yeah. So far, so good, yeah.
If it's, no,
yeah, you're good.
Go ahead.
You're good.
We won't have this.
No, you're good.
You have the back.
You're good. You move and I will work with you.
All right, we'll just keep it. Is that right about where you want it?
You can move forward. You've got plenty of room. You're not a roamer.
Yeah.
Move forward.
You know what?
You're good.
Say when.
You keep going.
So yesterday we had a family breakfast upstairs and I shared a little devotional about waiting on the Lord. We're going to keep talking about that this morning. I wrote a book about waiting upon the Lord. It's called The Work of Waiting. No one likes it. No one likes to wait. It's hard work to wait. But everything God does, whether he promises or prophesies or gives you something, set your heart on, there's waiting in the process. There's nothing that God does that doesn't require. Either he's waiting or we're waiting. There we go. That's better. That way I can see you. There we go. It's called The Work of Waiting. This is a 30-day devotional where you go through a little piece every day. I've given a set of these to Wendy that she can make available. They're $15 each. I don't make any money from these. We just reinvest the money to make more books. And so if you're interested in The Work of Waiting, see Wendy. Turn with me to Isaiah chapter 30. Isaiah chapter 30. We've been waiting for a pastor here. We've been waiting for growth and change. I believe it's on the way, but we still have to wait. It's just part of the process. Here's what he says in verse 18, if you want to look at this with me. Therefore, the Lord will wait, that he may be gracious to you. And therefore, he'll be exalted, that he may have mercy on you. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all those who wait for him. There's a sense where the Lord is waiting. But he's not waiting to be mean. He's not delaying. It's not his way of saying no. He waits that he may be gracious to us. It always turns out better if we get in sync with him. He waits also that he may be exalted. I think if we get everything we want, instant gratification, after a while we'll think it's our goodness or our righteousness or we did the right things and got the right combination. But it doesn't work that way. By the time what you're looking for comes about, you'll realize we had nothing really to contribute to it. The Lord did it because he's good. Also, he wants us to wait for him. And there's this whole thing where when you wait upon the Lord, we're being braided together with him. Where our mind and his mind become one. Our motives and his motives. He puts his motives in our heart. There's usually a change of motive that takes place. Our method, our ways are not his ways. Sometimes he waits to get us to be willing to do it his way rather than our way. But he has us wait not to be mean. He wants to be gracious to us. If my life was a four-burner stove, I got one burner where I'm in sync with what God's doing, another burner that's over bubbling, and two other burners that are waiting. I'm waiting for something in one area of my life all the time. I don't like it. I like instant gratification. I tap my toe waiting for the microwave oven. It's too slow. It's just my nature. I want things now. I want things to happen now. But everything God does require waiting. If he were to prophesy to you, speak to you, you'd still have to wait. He called David a king, a young 15-year-old boy, anointed him in front of all his brethren. And you would think, you know, he's anointing this boy as king. If you read the story, it's like a 10-year period before he's actually put in as king. And most of that time, he's in the wilderness. He's going through changes. He's growing. It's just what God does. There's a waiting period. Elijah got his first word from the Lord. He's called to be a prophet. He's been trained and prepared to be a prophet. His first word was, "It will not rain until I say it will rain." Then you watch, James says it was a 3.5-year period before he saw rain again. And if you read the story, most of that time he's waiting in a riverbank. Part of the time he's in the house of this widow, right in Jezebel's backyard, right in her hometown, right under her nose, he's waiting. James says he's a man just like us. He has emotions, desires. Imagine spending enough time in a riverbank that the river goes down to nothing, where there's no more water. Birds are coming twice a day to feed him. He had the word of the Lord, but he spent most of the time waiting. And then it bubbled very quickly where he says, "Now go and anoint this person, do this, do that." Where all of a sudden he went from flat line to extreme tension, extreme anxiety. And I know what that's like. That often happens. Here's the most interesting part about waiting. Go with me to Exodus. Exodus chapter 24. Verse 12. Children of Israel come out of Egypt. They've been waiting there 430 years. They had a promise from God that he was going to lead them out. Even Joseph believed it and said, "When it's time to go, take my bones with you." He believed what God was saying, even though 430 years. Stop and think about this. America is only, what, 250 years old? Can you imagine almost twice as long, where you're in bondage, you're a slave? They get let out, and Moses doesn't know the Lord. He's getting to know the Lord. And this is something God said to him. Verse 12. They're at the base of this mountain, and the Lord says, "Come up to me on the mountain and be there. Come up to me on the mountain and be there. And I'll give you revelation. I'll give you tablets of stone and the law and the commandments which I've written, that you may teach them." So come up on the mountain. So here's the mountain. This is the scene. The mountain is a local earthquake. Rocks are flying in every direction. The mountain is on fire. Plus, there's this eerie sound of a trumpet blaring from the mountain. Everything, and there's lightning and thunder. Everything we don't like is happening on this mountain. And the Lord says, "Get up on the mountain." You picture Moses leaving the crowd, his congregation, and he starts walking toward our earthquake and lightning and fire. And he's kind of looking back every now and again like, "What am I doing? How crazy is this?" And he's going alone. And he gets up on the mountain, and you could go to this mountain today. The mountain actually exists. It's in Saudi Arabia, and you can go there, and the top of it's blackened by fire. You could go there. And there's nothing there. No chairs. The Wi-Fi reception is terrible. There's no bed. There's no food. He gets there, and the Lord said, now be there. Get there. I'm going to give you a revelation. I'm going to speak to you. I've camped a lot in the wilderness, especially when I was a teenager. It's hard to be in the wilderness alone, but there's nothing to do. And you think the Lord's going to speak to you because he said, be there, I'm going to speak to you. And you're there all day, and nothing happens. I don't know if you ever spent this time on a mountain. I have all night. It gets cold. You got a choice whether to sit, stand, or lay down. There's nothing to do, no one to talk to. And he's expecting. That's part of waiting, is expectation. So he's expecting. He's up on the mountain. Can't build a fire, but there is some residue of fire all around him. He's there, and nothing happens. He waits all night. Gets up early in the morning, can't have coffee, no breakfast. But he starts waiting into the day, and it gets hot during the day and then cold at night. He waits all the next day and all the next night. And then all the next day and all the next night. And then all the next day and all the next night. Then all the next day and all the next night. 7 days goes by. That's a long time to wait. If you're expecting God to visit you and speak to you, that's a long time to wait. Finally, the Lord spoke to him. Now, here's what's interesting. God knew he was there all the time. God could have came in the first 5 minutes. God could have came, but there must have been something that he wanted to change in Moses. There must have been something he's after. There's something that maybe you don't appreciate the revelation unless you have to wait for it. God knew he was there. Why did he wait 7 days? He knows we need a pastor here. I've been praying. I've been pacing the halls praying. By the way, don't the halls look nice?
Yes.
He knows what we need. Sometimes he's after something in us, but he wants to be gracious to us. He's not doing this to be mean. He's trying to be gracious to us. But waiting was part of the process. Imagine Joseph. Joseph's a teenager. God comes to him and says, I'm going to make you great. He had a vision of people bowing down to him, his own mother and father, his brothers. He had a vision. It was a real vision from God. And God's going to use me. God's going to, I'm valuable to God. He has a plan and a purpose for me. And then God opened doors that no man could close and closed doors that no man could open. He didn't know it. The first door that God was going to open for him to greatness was a well. Sometimes the way to go up is you have to go down. It's humbly. He's thrown in a well. He can hear his own brothers talking about how they're going to kill him. And then they decide that they're going to sell him, but not for much. Because he's of no value to them. And he can hear the whole thing. Next door God opens is the door to a country and a language. People that don't love him. He don't speak the language. He doesn't eat the food. And he's stripped naked and sold on an auction block. And God opens the door to Potiphar's house. And there God favors him and he's used. He's got a plan. He's got purpose. He's great in Potiphar's house. But it's not the level of greatness that God had in mind. Then he's falsely accused. That happens. And Potiphar is the captain of the king's personal bodyguard. And there's a prison under his house. He's falsely accused. He's thrown in the prison. The Psalms, it says, the fetters, the chains, cut into his skin. And he's there. And he has a vision of God using him. And now he's in a little cell in a prison. nowhere to go, nothing to do, except wait. How are you going to do this? How are you going to get me out of here? You gave me a vision of my people bowing down. I'm in a prison in a foreign land. I don't know if you've ever been in a foreign land by yourself where you're the only one. I've been to Calcutta by myself in the middle of the night where I don't know anybody and surrounded by a group of men who want my stuff. And all you can do is trust the Lord, get you out of it. And he waits. And he waits. And then there's favor from the prison guard. Then there's two guys put in prison, and through the gifts of the Spirit, one of them is set free, and he says, I stand right behind the king. He's the king's cupbearer. Wherever the king goes in the palace, he's right there with him, serving him. Not just wine, but other things. But he's within ear range of the king. He says, you've helped me. I will get you out. I will tell the king that you're a righteous man. You're trapped in this awful situation. I will get you out. Can you picture that night? Joseph packs his rags and then sits on the edge of the bed waiting for the footprints, sandals coming down the hallway, waiting for the clang of keys. And he's listening. When they're coming, he's probably in the throne room right now, right behind the king. It'll just be a few minutes. Maybe the king's busy, but he'll speak to the king. Surely he'll speak to the king on my behalf. And he's waiting, and he waits all that night. And surely they'll come first thing in the morning. He gets up, he's pacing, he's ready for the keys to jangle, freedom, home, being back with my mom, my dad, my people, my language, my food. Nothing happens all that day, and then all that night, and all the next day, and all the next night. And he waited for 3 years. Actually, I think it was 2 years. Nothing happened for 2 years. That's a long time to wait. And then there's that moment where the king had a dream, and the guy said, I know a guy. He's right here in the palace. He's right here. Get him. And what's amazing, God did such a transformation in Joseph. He did such a deep work. He flushed his heart with forgiveness, got rid of all the bitterness, all the resentment of being sold and hated by his own brethren. Potiphar's wife lying about him, losing his job. Then the guy that forgot about him, king's cupbearer, he had all that dealt with. He had changed. You know what they had to do? When Joseph finally came out, they heard the keys clanging. Here's what they did. They shaved him, and they changed his clothes. And he walked out of that prison, right into the king's court, like a king. He didn't need psychotherapy. He didn't need medication. He didn't need rehab. He didn't need any of that. God had done that during the waiting. Think about this. Joseph walked into Pharaoh's court like a king. That night, he woke up in his prison that morning. That night, he's riding around Egypt in Pharaoh's chariot. And everybody's bowing down, and he's the second greatest man in all the earth, but the greatest man calls him Father. And he saved his people. He found out, he had a revelation. He said, when he got to talk to his brother, he said, you didn't do this to me. God did this. God sent me ahead to save the people, save my people. God had a prayer. Well, that was a revelation. That was a revelation he could only have gotten out of a heart that was free from bitterness and resentment and pain and said, this is me. And he made him great. And his mom and dad did bow down. His brethren did bow down. And the king of Egypt bowed down. I mean, he was the greatest man in all the earth. It all came to pass. But the route God took him to greatness was different than anything he could have ever imagined. Maybe our waiting together as a church here has more to do with the salvation of the city than we realize. Maybe if it happened too easy, too fast, we'd think we're something, or we'd start working in our own power. But I think to get this city on fire for God and saved is going to take a different mindset than we have right now. But the answer is on the way. 430 years in bondage is unbelievable. Abraham had a vision of this terrible time. It was a nightmare. And his people, his children, did go through that nightmare. And they cried out to God. They said, God, get us out of here. Deliver us. You promised you would. They had a promise to stand on. Everyone believed it, but it took a long time. They're crying. They're being whipped. They're being used up as slaves. Terrible, terrible conditions. One of the biggest slums in the world. And one night, a baby's cry went up with their cries. And a baby boy, a beautiful baby boy, was born. And the answer to the prayer was on the way. They didn't know it. It would take 40 years for him to grow up and realize that I'm not really Pharaoh's blood and bone. These are my people. And he had this revelation. Stephen said that he knew that he was to be a deliverer for the people of God, but no one else knew it. But he knew it. I'm called to be a deliverer. I'm to set these people free. It'd be another 40 years waiting in Midian. But the answer was on the way. The answer to their prayers was in motion. They didn't know it. Then when God met him at the burning bush, introduced himself, gave him power, gave him authority, gave him a staff, he still had to get to Egypt and walk in the Pharaoh's court. All of it was in motion. It just didn't look like it. It looked like more bondage to the people. But the answer was on the way. And you can see this all through the Bible. Daniel has a revelation. He's been reading the book of Jeremiah. And he says, oh, we're only supposed to be in Babylon 70 years, according to Jeremiah's word from the Lord, promise. He started fasting and praying and said, Lord, you said. Lord, you said. You said we're on our way out of here. And he began to fast. And he fasted day and night, day and night, day and night. He just kept fasting. He was out in this fast so far, farther than most people had ever been. And an angel came and spoke to him. He fell, he hit the ground. And the angel said, from the first time you afflicted your soul and began to fast and pray, we heard you in heaven. And God said, there's been a battle in the heavens. It's not been easy for me to get here. But he said, oh, Daniel, oh, beloved of God, the first time you began to fast, the first time you began to pray, the answer was on the way. The Egyptian bondage was horrible. The Babylonian bondage was horrible. But for the people of God, the worst bondage was the Roman bondage. They wanted that bondage broken. And another baby was born, and another cry in the night. They're praying for the Messiah. They're praying for a king to come and get them and break the Roman rule. These are pagans, setting up idols right in the temple, setting up all kinds of stuff. Just like a Russian occupation of Ukraine, that kind of horrible, horrible condition. And they're praying for a deliverer. And they hear the voice of John the Baptist preaching, and they gather around him, and they say, are you the one? Are you the king? Are you God's Messiah? And he says, I'm not. But there walks among you one that you don't recognize who is. And the next day, Jesus walks by and he says, behold the Lamb that takes away the sins of the world. The answer was among them. They just didn't see it. Sometimes you're waiting and God's working. And we withdraw our faith and we say, oh, it's taking too long. It seems impossible. And if you can hear God, he's saying, hey, I'm working here. The answer's on the way. I think there's something about us saying, look, I prayed the will of God. I can't feel it, I can't prove it, but I'm going to stand and say the answer's on the way, and I'm going to start thanking him. The way I'm going to react now the way I will when I see it, with gratitude and praise, even though I haven't seen it. It's a powerful promise for me in 1 John. Where John says that if we pray the will of God, we know that he hears us. If we know he hears us, we know he'll do it. There's things that we're praying for healing. We know that's the will of God. But sometimes it doesn't show up right away. But what if we said, I prayed the will of God? John said, if I pray the will of God, he'll hear me. If he hears me, I know he will do it. And then we start acting like he heard us. You say, well, that's faking it. It's not. It's faith. It's faith. It's faith in him that he's faithful. It's faith in him that he's a man of his word. It's faithful. It's having faith in someone says, you would not give me an expectation and then not fulfill it. You would not make me pregnant and not deliver. I'm praying your will. I'm praying what I believe is your will. I'm going to start reacting now with gratitude and praise and worship the same way that I will on the day when I see it with my very eyes. But I'm going to do this by faith. I think his chest will swell. I think he'll love that kind of faith. Faith in him. Faith that he's faithful. There's prayers you've been praying that probably got heaven busy. I'll even say that different times. I'll pray and I'll say, now I know heaven just got busy. Angels were dispatched. Stuff is happening. I can't see it. I can't feel it. But I pray. Let's not withdraw our faith. Let's not cast away our confidence. Let's believe. Let's be faithful. Because he's faithful. Here's the catch. I'm going to stop speaking here in a minute. It's not waiting that changes things. Prisoners are waiting in prison but aren't changed. I think it's waiting well. It's not waiting with the remote in our hands, waiting for stuff just to get better. I think it's waiting in faithfulness. I think it's waiting in worship. I think it's waiting in praying in tongues and singing in tongues. I think we can wait well and see the thing actually happen in a way that's honorable. Or we can wait and not be changed, not be transformed. We can wait in resentment, wishing. We can wait in wishfulness. I don't think that's going to work. I think we have to wait in hope. I think we have to wait in faith. I want to wait well. There's stuff I'm waiting for right now. I want my waiting to please the Lord. Because he's going to be gracious to us. I know this waiting business is not easy. It's not easy for me. It's not easy for you. But let's wait well. Amen?
Amen.
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 Amen. Can we stand together? Why don't you pray this? Lord, I don't like to wait. It's hard for me. But you're gracious. And you're waiting too. You're probably waiting for me. Waiting for me to change. Waiting for me to be moving in faith. Or the things that you've made me desire, the things you've given me an expectation. Help me to wait well. Help me to wait in a way that pleases you, honors you. Help me to wait. thank you that the answer is on the way. In Jesus' name. Amen. I don't get to tell you very often. I love you. I'm grateful for you. I'm glad we're together. We're in this thing together. I'm waiting. You're waiting. I don't think I can say that. But in the meantime, we're occupying. We had a group of people come and a professional painter named Jamie Golden, Golden's Painting Service. They come. They painted the halls. They're not finished. We have to wait. Yost went and fixed the side door, did a masterful job making that much more weatherproof. It works so much better. All the old wood was taken out. He's a real craftsman. He built that. Yost is here. I'm grateful for you, Yost, for doing that. The guy coming, he's going to put in a whole new security system somewhere, maybe by the end of the month. We're waiting. We're waiting for all kinds of stuff to happen, but we want this place to shine. We think that more new people are coming that don't know us. And when they come here, the place should look shiny and clean and bright, welcoming. When they come, I want you to reach out, get past yourself, and introduce themselves. Introduce yourself to them. Be friendly. Be more. If we were going to have friends, we got to show ourselves friendly. Last Sunday, there was a guest here who was looking for a church, and a friend brought them here. That surprised me. I'll tell you, it really encouraged me that somebody brought someone here because they're looking for a church. I think they'll be back. I think they're visiting in Penyon this morning, checking that out. But I want them to come back. When they do, make sure you feel welcome. The Thornton family's in the back row. They take up a whole pew. That family takes up a whole pew. This is James and the girls. Is it Emily?
Lisa.
So glad you're here. They're over on the other side of the lake. Get a chance to meet them. Anybody else who's visiting today? Well, we're here. I know there's some people away. Last week, this was pretty full. It won't be long. What I'm waiting for, it won't be long. I want to be back in the auditorium. Mm-hmm. The kids have a little more space. But I believe before long, we will be back in that auditorium. I'm waiting for that. I'm waiting. I'm longing for that. Amen? Amen. I call it auditorium. Sanctuary.
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 That's where you're born.
We called ours a sanctuary as well, then we switched out the auditorium, and I have to get my head around all these. You use different words than I do in different places, but you know what I mean, right? I'm going to be back in the big room.
Yeah,
big room. Can you believe with me and stand with me and start acting like that's going to happen? That's a done deal. I believe it's a done deal.
It's true.
It's just, we just have to wait for it, but it's a done deal. We're going to grow. We're going to grow. People are going to be added. Who God is sending, they're just not here yet. Listen, God bless you. Have a great afternoon. Go Bills. Right?